What up, bro?
What's up, baby boy? How you feeling, man?
I'm hot as shit. It's hot as shit. Nah, but I actually want to write to you, see how you been, though.
Everything been good, man. Everything been good. We rolling?
Yeah, bro.
That's the coolest thing about this. Man. You just bring it in. What's up? Can I dab you up? We go out and say, oh, my God.
It's no pressure, nothing like, it ain't no... Nothing like scripted or anything.
Right.
Yeah, not that. I just wanted to check you out. Like, what's going on, man?
Man, everything cool, man. Everything cool. You know, it's a constant struggle, man, in this world. You know what I mean? But we here. And I thank God for the fact that we here. You know, despite everything that's going on. And the fact that we even got the wiggle room to even try stuff out, mess up, or succeed, or learn, or all that, man. So, that's where I'm at.
Nah, facts. It's funny that you said you got the... It's the wiggle room to try a lot of things. Cause we was just talking about that, me and my man, Sosa and shit.
Yeah, shout out to Sosa.
Yeah, shout out to my nigga. Was that what you did with the reality TV show? Was that like just trying something new?
Let me tell you how God worked, man. I had like a vision. I'm not lying, yo. I feel like I had a vision. I don't know what everybody else mean when they say it, but I'm certain. I had a vision, bro, and it was like, me years forward in my career, successful and being interviewed, and someone going back in my like past and digging up the fact that we was on that show, right? And the fact that nobody would have known it, and it's, but they all know Big Fred, and they all know who Fred is. And to be honest with you, that's kind of what the experience played out like. It happened. It was dope. We won. I'd hate it if we went on there and didn't win. Right. So we won. And I think sooner or later, yo, it's going to be that moment where it's like, yeah, y'all know Fred for this. This guy, he used to be on this reality show.
Somebody want to send a diss song to you.
Like. Yeah. Oh, well, no, they can't diss me. I think I would want, I'm like the most winningest guy on the TV show.
Nah, that's
because the team fun. Won and then I won one.
Facts.
Yeah, bucket list.
Nah, so how was like, I always wanted to know, how was it though?
Yo, reality TV is crazy, Jay.
Nah, dead ass though, like me and you type, how was it? Like, not the commercial answer and shit.
No,
like,
it's not a commercial. All right, look, it's crazy. You think of other stuff, yo, like the hot tub and all that, and the pool and the chicks walking off, around. And that's true.
Mm-hmm.
But I was so excited about the stuff I didn't think I was going to be excited about.
Like what?
Like the food, bro. Like, they had unlimited food.
I feel like you bullshit. Like, you feel me? Did you get it? Did you bust it down?
Yeah, you seen it? You ain't seen the episode? Come on, Jay. You got it. I seen it.
Was on, I think I watched it on, like, Comcast.
Bro, I used to watch all the reality shows when I was little, yo, and watch it. Every time they go to the club, they bring a young lady from the club, and then you see the night light, and then the cover's moving. And for me to be the covers moving, yo, that's a beautiful thing. Bro.
See, I never watched reality TV, and I feel like you know why I watched that show. That's the only reason why I even watched that show.
Yeah, I remember that. Why?
That was the only reason I watched that shit. So it's like
I mean, bro, it was good. I think it was a good show, man. It wasn't scripted. A lot of people, you know, could have assumed or would have thought, but it wasn't scripted at all. It was pretty much free range for real. Like, it was, you know, do what you want.
So, like, do you think that aligned with what you're trying to do as Big Fred, the comedian? Because I see you do a lot of motivational speaking and stuff.
Yeah,
like that.
Yeah, that was the thing, yo. I thought about doing it when we got the invitation and we went through all that, and it was like real. I was like, yo, do I really want to do this? Because I never knew anybody that was famous in their passion or their craft that did reality TV at the time. Like, it wasn't, you know, it wasn't like a Cardi B, to say the least. You know what I'm saying? So it was like, yo, I seriously want to pursue something. So do I want to, like, make that faulty by my reality TV? And that's what I meant by, yo, I think I can really go on there and be successful, but it still be an afterthought per my actual career.
Right.
And I think that's how it's actually going to happen. People see me and they know me from the show, but it's almost like they formed a relationship. So once they see me on the show, they found my Instagram, and now I'm synonymous with comedy. So it's like they rock with my journey.
Facts.
You know what I'm saying? So I really don't have too much to do with the reality TV show. It's more like the reality.
No, I guess
it's kind of cool, yo.
So, it's funny because, like, I seen you the other day, well, just yesterday,
mm-hmm.
and I was like, what you doing?
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like, what are you doing now?
Yeah.
That the show is over.
Right.
Now it's back to Baltimore.
Mm-hmm.
What's up with Big Fred?
This is the thing, man. A lot of people don't know this story. They might see a little bit of it. But After the reality show, we came back before they let us know that we could announce it. Mm-hmm. It was like, yo, why the reality show when y'all can't work? I was like, you can't work.
But they said you can't work.
Like, you can't work. It was like, yo, you can't work while the show went. I don't know if they wanted us to get some type of illusion or something that we wouldn't. I don't know.
You can't have 9 to 5.
You cannot have 9 to 5. So I was like, huh? Like, you know, that's kind of wild. But in our particular case, none of us really did except for me. You know what I mean? Like, so Stars went on tour, you know, and everyone else was, you know, most of entrepreneurs and that, right? You know, dad does modeling and everything like that, Sierra Page and stuff. So I was like, yo, I need to do something, you feel me? Outside of just what I was doing on the comedy tip. So I started to volunteer.
Mm-hmm.
You feel me? I started to volunteer. I'm like, yo, I can do this, you feel me? And I just, you know, on the side and just do my comedy thing. And in volunteering, it put me like right back in the face of the community. You know what I mean? And I always told people that I'm like a product of community programming. Like, I'd be dead or just someone else. Like, that's a cliche term. People say that a lot. But in Baltimore, that's like 100% true. Like, in any wrong move, wrong instance, different thing that happened in your life, you could easily not be it. So it just put me right there, bro. And I sat there and I still been, of course, building my company. But I took real life steps in the building a foundation towards a company that can merge corporate and community through comedy. And it's very intentional. It's Big Labs company, it's licensed. Mm-hmm. I have an anti-bullying campaign, Lil Labs, just right under that. Yeah. And I've just been really working towards it. And it was just like, I had to have that conversation with myself, like, yo, you're not gonna feel satisfied. A lot of people told me, yo, you can't pour out an empty cup. I get that. A lot of people said, yo, you need to, you know, reach this level first. You know, yesterday, you know, Frank and I was talking about it a little bit, but it's just a commitment I made to myself because I know I wouldn't be satisfied without it. So just laying down a strong foundation that as I pursue my career, my goals, that this can just be there and continue to grow instead of doing it later.
That conversation with Frank, though, like, now I'm trying to figure out, like, because we always, he basically was saying you got to worry about yourself.
Right, right.
And you hear people say that, and there's certain people that are really good at that. Mm-hmm. It's other people like yourself, and I would like to say myself, mm-hmm. that we know that, or we try to do that, but we can't.
Yeah, but even if you remember with Frank, right? Frank, and I brought it up when I was doing, when I was just, you know, performing. Even him, he got to that point where he had to even say that he got caught up, where he had to watch his words, because some people are just good people. Some people just have that in them.
But do you think that if you focus on yourself, that makes you not a good person?
No, absolutely not. Absolutely.
How do we draw that line?
Absolutely not. I think it's just about, I can't give you a commercial answer. I can't even really give you a heartfelt answer because I really don't know. Yeah. Like, it's something that I'm going through right now. It's something that I'm learning right now. So y'all getting this real time. It's not. But, you know, we here, man. I see what you do. You know, I'm participating with you in the home of the 48 hours of being home. Shout out to that. And, man, this is where we from, bro. I don't even know if we can tell them where we at location right now.
Go ahead.
I grew up.
From the hood.
And it's just knowing my situation and knowing those around me and knowing how, like, small the differences can be to really change somebody's life. It's like, I had somebody tell me, like, yo, the kids don't get excited about you as a comedian when you come into the schools. Maybe when they find you funny, or maybe when you tell them or show a picture that you work with, they get excited about a DC Young Flower or, you know, so-and-so. So why don't you become that first?
Mm-hmm.
Then they can da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And I get that, but I feel like everybody got a different color. And when kids do get excited about me in schools, and I start to get that reputation, so then now they're excited just by hearing that I'm in this school, or this song, they, you know, performing with their cousin or whatever. It's
with their cousin.
Oh, you know, I mean, not with their cousin. Like, they come, I mean, you know, I'm school from school. I had to happen all the time. People DM and tag.
No,
but I'm saying that even those little instances, and I don't even want to sound naive. I hate to sound, maybe sound naive to some people, but even those little instances, I feel like make a difference, man.
No, that's a fact.
Because I just remember my life, and I had instances.
So you believe in, like, just getting in the schools and talking to them now while you're not that person? Like a DC Young Fly, having them grow with you?
Yeah, well, this is what I do with Lil Labs, right? I'm not saying, just like you said, if you care about yourself, that doesn't mean you're a bad person.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely not. If you're doing a lot for yourself, that doesn't mean you're a bad person. We might be faulty for not what people would consider maximizing ourselves first before we give back. Mm-hmm. You get what I'm saying?
No,
so it doesn't mean that you're a bad person. So what I do with Lil Labs is create a platform where people can now volunteer that if they're not committing their day-to-day. You know what I mean? Especially comedians. So now when DC Young Fly come to town, that's an open platform through comedy. Straight up, he can volunteer now. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of comics that's interested in that, and a lot of people, period. So that's another thing about it. It's not just saying, like, yo, you got to make a choice. I just feel like in my particular calling, this platform has created lanes for people to do that, even though that's not their day-to-day 24/7.
So what made you start the Lil Laughs?
Lil Laughs, you was having trouble with it earlier.
Yeah, I know. Because I know, it's Baltimore, so bad. Some people spell L-O-R.
Yo, you know, when I was thinking about what the name is, right? I always knew I was going to name it Lil Laughs the moment I knew I wanted to name the company Big Laughs. I knew that. But I forgot that we was in Baltimore, and I forgot that people might call it Lil.
I honestly hate that shit. I keep it 100. Like, I hate that L-O-R shit. I hate L-O-R, and I hate dummy.
You know what?
I hate that shit.
I said dummy the other day to some ducks when I was feeding them. I was like,
what?
No, because it's a long story, but basically,
you call ducks dummy?
That's the first time I ever used it, and I felt like I used it in a very perfect way, yo, and I understood why people use it. It was very casual, you feel me, for one time. And I've been okay with it. But when I said it, it was like, oh, all right.
How did you say it?
It was a term of endearment, yo. To the duck.
Hey, dummy, how you doing?
No, that was nice about it. Nah. Do people walk around Baltimore? Like,
yo, dummy.
Hey, hello, good afternoon, dummy. Like, right. Don't like talk like that, yo. Right. I just was like, hey, eat the bread, dummy. But it was cool because I had never said it before. Yo.
Eat the bread,
like,
dummy.
And then I thought about it, I'm like, oh, all right. But look, yo, we start a little laughs. It's L-I-L. You know, apostrophe, laughs.
All right, but
we started a little laugh show because, really, man, when I started comedy, I started comedy in 2013, right? Knew I was going to do stand-up in 2013. And maybe about a year in tour, I was like, yo, I'm on this journey. And I just always felt like my journey was synonymous with inspiring or motivating other people. Mm-hmm. And in that way, that's just something I wanted to bring forth. So I remember, you know, we was in college at the time. We all had our, you know, college buzz. It's the same thing now. It's just way real.
I mean, we was lit in college.
It's real. It's getting real and real. But I knew we had influence, man. I'm one to always feel like people should use their influence. So I had put an event together at the community center I grew up at, the Door down the hill on Chester Street, and we called it Lil Laughs, and it was an anti-bullying like comedy show is what we called it. And John Boy, shout out to John Boy, he helped me out a lot. Like, we really, you know, did a lot for it. And we had Lil Key come out. That's when he first started rapping. And he just had, like, posters and stuff like that. And the kids was getting autographs and all that. And then they didn't know him. And then, you know, years later, they see him. And I'm sure they're somewhere in their living room with their mom. And they're going crazy. So that speaks to, like, those moments that we talk about, providing those moments that really had those small effects that really mean something.
Facts. It seemed like, I'm not gonna lie, it seemed like the people that's not selfish and the people that want to get back to the community and things like that, it seems like they not really getting the recognition they deserve. And it seems like the other people that's all for self, they're the ones that's blowing up. So, like, what...
Yeah, well, I mean, you gotta look at the way the world is, yo. Like, you gotta look at the way the world is. The more popular, prominent people of the world aren't, you know, selfless of the world, and the people that was seemingly, you know, selfless or for people, they had to embrace being poor or, you know, things that wasn't wealth. So it's kind of already put out there like that. It's just up to, you know, if people had the, whoever got the will to really put themselves through it and really live what they feel like in their heart for.
No, that's a fact. So, being that you're like selfless, very selfless, with a L-E-S-S, selfless.
Yeah. And I still like money, yo.
Yeah. But I'm just trying to figure out what do you think is keeping you, what's holding you back from being that next big comedian?
Man, I think about it, but I feel like it's all self. You know what I mean? I've gone through plenty of self challenges and growth moments and things like that, but I really do feel like I have a purpose, you know? I mean, we all got purpose, but I just feel like I have a purpose, and comedy is just one of the vehicles to drive that purpose. So most of public speaking, like, you know, mentoring and, you know, any one-on-one, whatever, you know? Anytime that I can share my experience or continue to learn and pull out, I feel like that's what it is. I feel like building a foundation with Big Laughs and using comedy to bridge corporate and community, feel like it's very intentional. And I think sometimes we get caught up, you know, with the Instagram society and stuff like that, where it's people that it might die, they get high and it's substanceful, you know, but they might not know how to sustain it. Right. Or they'll be seemingly high and it's not substanceful, and it just messed their life up that much more because now they all these people, now all these people think of. So it's like, I'm just interested in really building a foundation, man, and changing my reality. Like, we came from nothing, and I look forward to trying to build something that I can really, you know, pass down generations and find a void, you know what I mean?
Nah, that's a fact, bro. I mean, I think that's...
In 2018, man, like I said, like, in 2018, if you can find a void, man, you ain't no math, nigga, you ain't no computer whiz, but you was able to find a void, you feel it. And with what we doing with comedy, I feel like we identify the void, and it's intentional too, and it's genuine too, and that's rare. We got so many people finding voids to fill. They don't give nothing about, you know, people floating around, hovering around Baltimore City after the riots and all that. Yo, we can put money in, do this, do that, do that. But they don't care though. You know, they're just finding voids because that's what business people do. Mm-hmm. So in this case, you know, I feel like we found a void that we can fill using our arts and our talents and providing a lot of wealth and resources, you know, to one another.
You said it, man. I don't know. It was a good conversation.
Yeah, man. I ain't supposed to be like, but that's where we at.